Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. We are going to look at the business economics for first year, second semester. This is a video version of your model. Now, what does business economics mean? The same as managerial economics. You can replace business economics with managerial economics. So now let's see. Business economics is the application of economic theory and methodology to business. It's also called managerial economics. Now, what are some of the economic theories and methodologies that can be used to manage business? Here brings us to the scope of business economics. So here are the scopes. We have the demand analysis, we have cost and production analysis, pricing decision, profit management, and capital management. All these are the scope or the economic methodology or business theory that can be used to manage your business. That is the idea of business economics. Because business needs to analyze its demand and forecast before production. Business needs what? Factor cost-effective analysis before they cannot produce. Business also has what? Design pricing. So they must what? Take price decision before what? Production. And they must what? Optimize the profit that they will gain before what? Production. So you can see this chart. This chart elaborates the economic theories that the businessman cannot use to manage the business. So you can see economic theory and concepts, demand and supply methods that can be used to what? Manage your business. We have the quantitative approach that the business has what? Used to manage the business. They are all what? The business theories or economic theories that the business can use to what? Manage the business. Under the managerial economics, we have using both economic theory, concepts, and quantitative approach to what? To make managerial decision. You must take quantitative approach before you cannot decide on what to produce, how and when to produce. This is the concept and scope of what? Business economics. Also, we are moving to fiscal and monetary policy as a topic under business economics. What does it mean? Governments use both fiscal and monetary policies in order to achieve economic stability, which means achieving a high economic growth rate and controlling inflation and full employment of the economic factors. Now, what is fiscal policy? Fiscal policy can be defined as a tool that the government uses to achieve its economic objectives. These tools are government spending and taxes. The government adjusts its spending levels and its tax policies. So with the help of fiscal policy, the government spot will be able to know how to spend the income, the taxes Ghanaians as contributed. So with the help of fiscal policy, the government uses what? It what? Achieve its economic what? Objectives. Now, again, it is not a deliberate change in either government spending or taxes to stimulate or slow down the economy. So here, with fiscal policy, the government can decide to limit spending capacity or can decide to what? To enlarge or increase the taxes on individual or on companies within the country. Here, there are two types of fiscal policies that the government can use. We have two types of fiscal policies that the government can use to manage the economy. We have expansionary fiscal policy. What does this one mean? With the expansionary fiscal policy, it involves government decreasing the taxes. Either you decrease the tax or increase government spending. With the expansionary fiscal policy, it has the idea of decreasing taxes. Either you decrease the taxes given to people or you want to increase the government spending. That is expansionary fiscal policy. Now we have another type called contractionary fiscal policy. With this one, it involves increasing taxes or decreasing of government spending. With this construction, the government can choose to increase the taxes of people or companies within the country, or choose what? Decrease government spending. So these are the two types of what? Fiscal policies any government can use. Now with this break of pandemic, what do you think as an economic student the government is using? Here, the government is typically using expansionary fiscal policies. This is because the government is that creating, let's say, interest or tax-free for our frontline workers, which is the nurses, right? And trying to give free electricity, free water bills, and providing foodstuffs for people. Here, the government is spending much on us. Automatically, he is using us expansionary fiscal policies. I hope you get this point well. Now, it continues. Professor Kalesian argues with this. He is not economic professor. He says, in times of recession, spending is a public good that benefits everyone. Now, with Professor Kalesian, we agree with him perfectly, because let's see this pandemic, let's consider it is a recession, because every economy is in a recession. Things are not moving one well. So Professor Kalesian argued that in this time, you have no option than to spend, right? You have no option not than to spend on the earth, on the individuals. The economy is below potential income during recession. And a recession means a slowdown of economic activities. In the layman's understanding, the country or the economic the economy is going back, like things are slow, right? That is what a recession. And with this type of coronavirus, it's a typical and empirical example of a recession. Hence, the government must spend more. Now, there is a recession gap. What is the meaning of a recession gap? It is a gap which is the difference between the potential income and equilibrium income. When potential income exceeds equilibrium income, we call it recession gap. Let's move to the objectives that government focus on us implementing fiscal policies. What are the aims of fiscal policies? First one, the first and the most important objective of fiscal policy is the full utilization of resources. This, it will eventually increase the employment rate and improve the standard of living in the economy. Without fiscal policy, we will not see, I will not be able to see that the government in power has been able to what? Employ much. Here, fiscal policy what? Unveil it to you to see full utilization of what? Resources. Again, price stability is the second objective of fiscal policy. Why? Because it can be what? Achieved through balancing between the aggregate demand and aggregate supply to avoid price inflation. Also, another objective of fiscal policy is to encourage investment. Fiscal policy affects the rate of what? Investment in the public sector, which in return will affect the rate of investment in the private sector. Again, other objectives is that fiscal policy include equal distribution of resources, optimization of resources, and to achieve the economic stability. Here, fiscal policy cannot reveal to you it is clear that this sector is doing well. This sector needs additional top up of financing. With the help of fiscal policy, it can help us towards know where to channel our resources effectively. Continuation of the objective is that fiscal policy can influence economic factors by adjusting government spending and taxes. With the help of fiscal policy, we can adjust government spending and taxes. How can this one be used? Because here, fiscal policy cannot tell us or reveal to us that this ministry is fully working and needs additional financing, right? As I earlier indicated, it helps us to rightfully channel and timely channel our resources. Last but not the least, in case of recession, let's see how fiscal policy helps. In case of recession, in case of where the government, the economy is going back or moving back, things are slow, right? Taxes are not coming. As I used earlier, indication of the coronavirus, we are in a bit of recession. The government should not use expansionary fiscal policy. Why? This is because the government was, by using expansionary fiscal policy, increasing government spending and not decreasing taxes. Which is, let's take Ghana for example, a typical and breaker example. Our water bill was given to us for 3 months free, as well as the light bills. Our frontline workers, the nurses, were out giving additional top up salary, and they are not what? Paying tax within some months. This is a typical example of recession, and we have used what? Expansionary fiscal policy to illustrate it. So, a government, a well-being government, who is seriously managing their affairs, to use what? Expansionary fiscal policy in these times. We are not in normal times, right? Now, in the next of all, increasing government spending will create more money in the economy and what? Help in creating more jobs and more economic growth rates. Don't forget, if we are pumping money into the economy, whereby decreasing taxes, here it means more hands can be employed in our industries by the use of what? Expansionary fiscal policy, decreasing taxes and increasing spending. I hope you get it. And with the help of expansionary fiscal policy, in case of inflation, the government may use contractionary fiscal policy in case of inflation, where prices of goods and services are increasing. The government must use what? A contractionary fiscal policy to manage the affairs of the state. How? By increasing taxes or decreasing government spending, or both. Here, you can use both to manage the affairs in case of inflation. Increasing taxes will not decrease the purchasing power of individual, which will result in the lower demand. This is very strategic, right? If you increase taxes, it will decrease purchasing power. Hence, individual works lower the demand of the produce. Hence, inflation will go down. So in case of inflation, contractionary fiscal policy need. Very most. Let's continue. We are done with the fiscal policy. Let's deal with the monetary policy, the differences. Now, monetary policy is a set of economic policies that manages the size and the growth rate of the money supply in an economy. It manages the growth rate and the size of money supply in the economy. Don't forget, this is money supply, right? In the economy. Let's amplify it a little. Monetary policy is basically used by the central banks, right? They are basically used by the central banks and governments to encourage the economic growth or to discourage the growth rate to avoid economic issues such as inflation, right? So this is what monetary policy. Now, when we are facilitating borrowing and spending to people and businesses, monetary policy will help the economy to grow faster, while limiting spending will make the economy grow slower. This is vis-a-vis. Without this, when you get this, you don't get this. When you get this, you get this. That is how it is. When we facilitate borrowing, when we allow people to borrow with ease to invest in their businesses, spending of business assets, monetary policy is the best. Giving access to people, right? Giving access to CEOs, small scale people, to come and have a lot of amount of money to invest in their business. And I learned last week, the government is what? Is launching something like that. The SMEs are able to what? To come for a certain amount of loans, which they will pay it, I think, 5 years time. This is monetary policy, because we are in what? A recession. The economy is slow because of the coronavirus. So the government has thought it wise that I should what? Facilitate borrowing loans to people with ease so that they can invest into their businesses, right? To boost their businesses. Now, let's move to national income and accounting. A very interesting topic, national income and accounting. What is national income? Let's do this introduction. The purpose of this topic is to study how the gross national product is measuring the economic activities of a nation. The concept is defined and explained. We are going to understand how national income is created. In the starting point is what? Macroeconomics. So this one is under macro, pure macroeconomics. So you are going to enjoy this topic with ease. Now let's first define national income. National income can be defined as the monetary aggregate of the current achievements of an economy without any double counting. Here it means what? Counting the summation of the goods and services within the economy without double counting. Right? It is estimated usually for what? 1 year. So national income is always counted or estimated every year. That is how it is. And let's move towards the importance of national income. Why national income is important to a nation? One, it helps in policy making and planning. Very simple, it helps in policy making and planning. Also, it helps in understanding and evaluating the performance of the economy. Here, it means with the accumulation or the summation of national income within a year or at the end of the year, it helps the economic policy in government to know how the economy is doing. Are you declining as economy or are you increasing? So, with the help of national income, it will help us to estimate or evaluate the performance level of the economy, right? And also, the third point is It helps in measuring inflation and deflationary changes. National income will help us to know whether the goods and services within the economy is moving up or growing, or it is what? It is declining. It is either increasing or declining. With the help of what? National income and accounting, we cannot know or notice the inflationary gaps or situations within the economy. Also, it helps in comparing standard of living, which is very clear. The national income here, when proper accounted for, help us what? Compare the standard of living in this country or in every nation. When the standard of living of the nation is low or poor, it means the economy is properly not what? Utilizing its resources very well, or employment is low. And how are we going to know this? Through national income and accounting at the end of the year. Also, it helps us, or it helps the economy, on how national expenditure is divided between what? Consumption expenditure and investment expenditure. With the national income and accounting at the end of the year, the economic team will help us to know where to channel our resources well, to know where is weak, hence needs investment. National income and accounting will help us to know. Let's move to how to measure it. How do we measure the national income? We have seen the importance. So here, how are we going to measure it? We cannot sit down one day or through the year doing nothing and estimate that this is the amount or the revenue the nation generated. No, unless you use some measures to what? To measure. Now, we have three methods that can be used to what? Measure national income and accounting. The first one is the production or value added method. In the bracket, we have total output. Here, the national income is measured with or through the production of goods and services the country produces. That is why it has put in the bracket what? Total output. The total output of goods and services a country is able to produce. They are used to measure national income. Also, income method. Income method is the summation of wages and profits. Right? Wages and profits given to the nation as government workers, paid to government workers, are used to what? Analyze or measure the national income in the economy. Also, total expenditure on final produce or products. Is also a method used what? Measure national income and accounting. Now, let's see the indicators. The indicators where we can tap to measure the national income. Don't forget, the measurements are all under the indicators, right? So we have the gross national products. You use gross national product to measure national income and accounting. How? The gross national product is the sum total of all final goods and services produced by the people of one country in 1 year. And the GNP, which is the gross national product, is a flow concept. It can be calculated with either the expenditure approach or the income approach. Here, it is the summation of what? The final goods within the country. Right? The summation of the final goods. And here, the summation is not like, let's say, Despite has able to what? Produce, let's say, one of his plants is production of Nifufu, the U2, whatever sort. We are not going to count that one. Right? But rather, in the monetary terms, the value of the money. Do you get it? So let's take the national, for example, the cocoa board will be able to tell you this year we produce or Ghana produce 10,000 tons of what? Cocoa. We are not going to what? Put all the 10,000 tons as what we have produced. We evaluate it in terms of money, monetary terms. right hand. That is summation. So here, the gross national products exclude intermediate goods, second-hand sales, as well as financial transactions. It says it excludes. When you are calculating gross national product, these things are not among. So the gross national product is a monetary amount. It's a money amount, as I said. It's not that you are going to bring all the cocoa. It's like, oh, this is what we have produced. But you know, in the monetary terms, right? And must be adjusted for changes in the value of money, as I earlier explained, right? It's exchange. The tons of cocoa are exchanged in the monetary value. That is what one indicator we use to measure our standard, right? The national, the income the country has what generated. We use gross national product for it. Also, one indicator is the gross domestic product. Here, the gross domestic product is the sum of all final goods and services produced by the residents of a country. Now, this one is residents of a country, not the gross national product. This is gross domestic. When something is domestic, the residents, the thing is within the country, right? So here, for example, as the NIA is registering the individual, the Ghana card, we are registering domestic Ghanaians. Who now here Ghana, you are Ghanaian, right? You are domestic. So here we are us measuring national income, we use domestic product where the residents of the country produces goods and services, then we count them as gross national products, right? So here it is telling us that if we're a foreigner and you come and open a plant or a factory here, during national income accounting, right, calculating our national income at the end of the year, we will not add yours, but rather we can add it to the gross national instead of the gross domestic product. Good. Now, upon measuring national income, there are some difficulties that make it very, very, very difficult to get accurate figures, right? Accurate figures. Now, the topic says limitations or difficulties in measuring national income. One, we have the black economy, in the bracket, black markets, distorts the figures. Here, when you see some people having instituted to themselves a black market, right? For example, those buying the dollar and the euros and those, they have a place called black market. So in a country where black market is very dominant, it is very difficult to get accurate national income figures. We cannot rely on our national income or the revenue brought by the statistician, right? Because there are some people somewhere trading black market, which we can't see what counts for, right? And another difficulty is inadequate and unreliable data. Sometimes the data is prone to what, double counting. So we cannot get accurate data and we cannot rely on that data as our gross or national income calculated at the end of the year. Also, illiteracy and ignorance. Some people here even don't know that this kind of business they are doing, they must pay tax so that we can count for, we can count them including the national income when counting them. At the end of the year, less than. So, illiteracy and ignorance makes it difficult to get accurate national income value. Also, production of goods for self-consumption makes national income accounting very difficult because some people at somewhere produce goods and services for themselves in the village. They don't even know that after selling, they should pay some tax. So here, it becomes very difficult to get accurate national income value. And the last one, lack of occupational classification. In the back, it says the account only measures paid activities. It's true. Now here,
In this country, we don't have
classification of occupations,
only based on the government workers, right?
Someone may be in someone's house as a housemaid, paid him or her a little token, and that money, the person may not pay tax or whatever, right? So this one, they are all what? They are all negativity. They are all difficult ways of what? Measuring national income. Hence, the person is what? Receiving something for salary or a token at the corner. So all these things makes national income very difficult when measuring it or counting it at the end of the year. Now let's move to macro market analysis. Under it we have savings, investment and consumption. Savings, investment and consumption. When you talk of savings, I believe you all save for future use. And this one is broad because it entails the economy. We are talking about the economy, not individual, right? So here, savings, the income received by a consumer that is not spent on the output of firms through consumption expenditure is savings. Investment, a purchase of capital goods not consumed but used in future production is investment. So here, get a clear definition, differentiation between the savings and what? Investment. When the investment has a prolonged time to use, right? Good. The consumption is the value of goods and services bought by people according to the need it satisfies. Maybe you need phone, you need something very urgently. The money that you use to buy, you have consumed it. Consumption doesn't always mean eating or putting the thing into your mouth. No. If you use your money to buy a phone, a laptop, television, or even a house, you have consumed it. So get the difference between savings, investment, and consumption. Now let's see factors that determines consumption. Things that what prompts up consumption, that makes us consume. Right? We have current income. We have cumulative savings in the past. Cumulative is the summation or addition of savings in the past. We have expectations of future income. Now, if you know that you have been able to what, save a certain percentage in your income, you are very reliable to buy whatever you want. It prompts you. For example, I needed a phone last week, and with my little income I saved, I was able to get one. So, factors that helps me to consume, to help me to get that phone, is that I have accumulated a certain amount of income. Also, cumulative savings in the past. You can save in the past towards purchase or consume it on a certain project or product that you want. Also, expectations of future income. You can consume because you expect that a certain amount of income will come, right? So for instance, for me, if I don't have money, I don't ask for anything, right? I don't ask the cost. But if I have the idea that, I will be paid, let's say, 1 month or 2 weeks time, I can go to the bank and say, I'll come and buy this one, right? It prompts me of consumption, to consume it. Now, we have relationship between the consumption and savings. There is a relationship between consumption and savings. Now, the relationship is that the relationship between consumption and savings is your income. Is your income, right? Because your income will determine how much to save and how much what to consume. That is the relationship. Without your income, you cannot determine how much to save. And anyone who saves without or who consumes without focusing or taking into account his or her income is not a good saver. you must take into account your income, how much you earn at the end of the month, so that you can consume or save some. So here it gives you income is equal to consumption plus savings. Right? Your consumption and savings pot gives you income. So let's use a mathematical example here. Let's say you receive 1,000 Ghana cedis as your income every month, at the end of the month. And your phone has spoiled and you want new phone. Hence, you've not married and you want to save a little for your wedding. So here, you must consider 1,000 Ghana cedis that comes into your hands at the end of the month. And know when to marry, because you have scheduled a year, a time that you do your wedding. So here you must have a little percentage, let's say 200 Ghana cedis somewhere, and put, let's say, 600 Ghana cedis somewhere. And at the end of, let's say, 5 months, you cannot accumulate the 200 Ghana cedis, 200 Ghana cedis, making 1,000 Ghana cedis to go and consume it on your phone. And this savings, you can also accumulate it, let's say you want to marry at the end of 2 years' time, so that the 2 years' time, you get what the amount you needed to marry. So here, the income will what? Teach you. It will direct you. It will tell you when to save, how much, and how much to consume. That is what? The relationship, right? So here, you see this equation here. This is consumption is equal to, this is constant, and this is your income, right? The F here is constant, so C is equal to small f into brackets y. And it explains that if income increases, consumption also increases, right? If income increases, consumption also increases, but not as quickly as income. Your income will not increase daily, but consumption always increases. Here, I think it's clear, because whenever your income increases, your taste of preference also increases. Let's say you were in a single room, that time you were receiving 700 Ghana cedis a month. Immediately you get a new job paying you 2,000 Ghana cedis, a single guy, you may prefer chamber and hall. This is what this statement says. If income increases, consumption always what? Increases. And let's see the equation for savings. S equals to small f into brackets y. The y is income. So here, if income increases, saving also increases. And I agree with this point perfectly. Because whenever your income increases, at first you were saving, let's say, 200 Ghana cedis with your 1,000 Ghana cedis income. When you receive 2,000, it must double or triple. Okay, so let's see. Propensity to consumption. It means how much income is consumed is propensity to consumption. So the equation is consumption per income. If you want to know how much your income is consumed in as a nation, your consumption value divided by income that you earn at the end of the month. That is in the percentage wise, okay? So here the PC, propensity to consumption, is how much you got consume your income. So let's say if you want to find out the percentage wise, you will say my income is 2,000 Ghana cedis. My income is 2,000 Ghana cedis, and out of it, I consume, let's say, 500 Ghana cedis. So 500 Ghana cedis by your income will give you the propensity in the percentage wise of consumption. Now let's see the marginal propensity of consumption. What does it mean? It means how consumption changes with changing income. The marginal means here how your consumption changes when the change of your income also arrives. Right? That one too is in a percentage wise. So MPC, marginal propensity of what? Or to consumption, is change in consumption per the change in income. Right? So how can you calculate this one? So let's see, first you were receiving 1,000 Ghana cedis, and now you receive 1,001. So here you must what? Deduct the 1,000 Ghana cedis from the 1,001. That is what the change that has come in your income. Do you get it? Yes, that's the change of income. So here it means you have a change of 100 Ghana cedis of what? Your marginal change of what? The income. So if you want to know it, you divide it by the change in consumption. Now, let's consider Professor Keynesian's theory on consumption, savings, and investment. He developed a certain theory of consumption, income, and what? Investment. He says, for a country to what? Measure or count its national income, this is the formula. Here is Y, which means income. How can you what? Get your income? It means you must add consumption and your savings. So your consumption and savings will give you what? Income. You cannot use this as your daily living. If you add your income, let's say you are receiving 2,000 Ghana cedis as your income, right? And you save 1,000 Ghana cedis from it. It has left 1,000 Ghana cedis in your pocket. The next day you what? You withdraw the 1,000 Ghana cedis from the bank. You added it. Is it not your income still? It's still your 2,000. So Professor Keynesian says that for the economy to what? Account for its national income, you can use this formula. The income is equal to consumption plus savings. So you add the consumption plus this savings, it gives you your income. Also, he uses this also formula. He says, your consumption divided by your income. Then add your savings divided by what? Your income, which is equal to 1. The 1 here is the 1 year, because national income is calculated always 1 year. Now with this formula, explains this formula. It's not another formula, this is just to explain this one. You may not understand. Now, how you see this sign? Change in consumption divided by change in income. Right? Change in consumption divided by change in income plus change in savings divided by change in income equal to 1 year. This is what Professor Keynesian brought up with, and it has been used by every nation with the economic policy team to what? Account for national income. How can you get change of consumption? A change of consumption is whereby last year you consumed 1,000 Ghana cedis on your rent. 5 years time, you consume 1,500 cedis on your rent. The change that has come in your consumption is 500 Ghana cedis. So this 500 Ghana cedis, you put it here. Then you come here, your income. This year, your CEO or your employer was paying you 500 Ghana cedis. In 3 years time, the employer says you are working hard. So top up with what? 200 Ghana cedis. So the change of your income here is the 200 Ghana cedis that has come. And you put it here. So here your 500 divided by your 200 Ghana cedis becomes this formula. Right? Then you add your change of savings per change of what? Your income. In all, equal to 1 year. Good. So here it tries to amplify the values here. Where Y is the financial year, C is the consumption, and S is the savings. Right? The financial year is trying to tell you your income in the financial year. And the C means your consumption, and the S is your savings, which is very clear. So these formulas of national income was designed or brought up by Professor John Maynard Keynes. We call him John Maynard Keynes. Put it in your head. When it comes to your objectives, you will be able to answer. He developed so many theories to consumption. It continues. Government taxes leaks out. So Professor Keynesian also brought these things.
Government taxes leak out of the circular flow model, and then government spending injects into the economy back. Thank you. Our next meeting is, we are going to embark on circular flow of income. Thank you.